Okay, I want to thank everyone for being here. Very glad to be here myself, and very happy to be brought on server on time by our producer, Danny Romero. And I want to kind of bring up Daniel Arola, the other Danny, because he brought to my attention, of course, the fact that many people are asking about the war crimes trials in Japan. So I need to contextualize those in context of Japanese victory, and particularly that of the Yamato dynasty under Emperor Hirohito. So I'll be doing that today historically. I know that there's plenty of things to be talking about in terms of current events, both on a personal level and on a social level. And societally, of course, what we have is the Unite the Right 2 rally, which is going to take place in Washington District of Columbia this weekend. Of course, I'm well aware of it. I'm well aware of the funds being raised, in particular by cryptocurrencies, for all of these white trash piece of shit neo-Nazis, which have nothing to do with the original National Socialist ideology of the Failed Reich, which was, of course, a global ideology, not an ideology for a bunch of morbidly inbred white trash pieces of shit. And so I can go into that after the event. God alone knows. There's no point in going into it beforehand because God knows what's going to happen, other than almost certainly, if it echoes last year, another attempt at rendering a human sacrifice will be made for the anti-gods, which are connected to the alt-right movements through, of course, the convolution, or that's the term that Michael Aquino would use for his version of revolution or de-evolution, the convolution of his anti-godly cults. We'll go into that, of course, on Monday. And as well, of course, enough people are aware of it now where I do need to contextualize it on Monday, that one of my primary gang stalkers, of course, died trying to conduct an assassination ritual against myself. I explained how this kind of assassination ritual was used by Michael Aquino, one of the few men who could actually conduct the ritual without getting himself killed. And that was, of course, the ritual of the summoning of the Angel of Death. This was something that was done with San Francisco Mayor Ed Lee, who died at a very specific time in last year. And when he died, of course, I spoke about it at some length. I was being heavily censored at the time. My gang stalkers were very active at the time and very aggressive in making certain I was censored on Facebook by constantly misreporting my Facebook timeline in various ways. And at that, after enough complaints filed by myself, literally what must have amounted to well over 100 over the half decade that I've been on Facebook, well over half a decade now, by maybe about 6 or 7 years, Facebook relented and no longer responds to those complaints on the part of gang stalkers. Also, they've been incredibly disastrously on their part disassembled. Of course, their primary child pornography trading site, BellGab.com, has been shut down. One of their primary pedophile, pedopornoholics, John Victor Lillier, who claimed to be a Green Beret, was, of course, nothing more than an infantryman, falsified all of his documents, was very favored by Michael Aquino, would accept money or mercenary contracts to attack genuine veterans and falsified documents to say that they were not real veterans. That way he would drive them to suicide by depriving them of benefits. Well, I brought, of course, a specialist from the Veterans Benefits Affairs Department who proved all of his documents were false on air. And of course, these records of this being proven on air are available. You can look them up via Rose Dio's Mystic Warrior YouTube channel. We'll bring up her YouTube channel, of course, as the transmission progresses, that John Victor Lillier is dead at the age of 62. And it was a ritual he tried to conduct against myself that did backfire. And of course, for those who have problems with belief in magic, then look at it this way. Psychosomatically, he believed in magic so much that when his spell casting backfired, he died based on extreme psychosomatic reaction, which generated a heart attack that forced him to be hospitalized. And he consequently, of course, passed on in terror and in pain, foreseeing, of course, his own damnation, which he had consigned himself to when he essentially converted to the cult of Michael Aquino. Now, John F. Kennedy said, you know, now that we turn towards history, this being, of course, the eve day of the Nagasaki bombing, and the Nagasaki bombing was on August 9th of 1945. We are on the eve day of that memorial date, and John F. Kennedy, who survived the Second World War on June 11th of 1962, said the following quote. He quotes now, "The greatest enemy of truth is very often not the lie, deliberate, contrived, and dishonest, but the myth, persistent, persuasive, and unrealistic." And it's that myth we're going to take on today in any number of mythifications around the bomb, around so-called Japanese surrender. Before we get into that, I am being reminded via an email to clarify what I said about John Victor Lillier. Yes, what I mean to say is that I will speak of him on Monday, as I have spoken of, as I will speak of the Unite the Right rally. There's just no, he's not worth the attention. In death, the one thing I can tell you, and Monday I'll elucidate on this, I knew that there had been a radical change in his health and that he had likely died because I stopped getting obscene phone calls from him towards the end of last month. And he died on July 26th. All of that will be covered on Monday to a greater extent. In the meantime, John F. Kennedy himself survived the Second World War. The most famous incident, basically the only combat action he was in, was that his patrol boat, the PT-109, was rammed and sank by the Fubuki-class destroyer, the Amagiri, which transliterates into something very loosely. It's very difficult to translate that particular word from the Japanese, but Amagiri would mean something like a very specific kind of misty sky where you have a kind of cloud that is not rain, but produces moisture that condenses on everything around you. That's what the Amagiri implies. And that was the name of the Japanese destroyer, a very specialized destroyer that rammed the PT-109. It is certainly the only ship to have ever sank a vessel skippered by a future American president. It was itself skippered by Lieutenant Commander KYŪJŌ-INBŌ-JIKEN, who had ordered top speed for the run back to Rabaul that night, where some of the fiercest fighting that ever took place in World War II occurred. The fighting was so fierce the Americans were never able to conquer or occupy Rabaul, as they were unable to do so with many Japanese islands, whether it was Wake Island, once captured by the Japanese, whether it was Marcus Island, Manami Mori Torishima, known as Monster Island, colloquially, whether it was any of the other islands that were occupied by the Japanese, very few were ever conquered and occupied. That's why they make a big deal of the ones they did. Now, that night, it was August 2nd or 3rd in 1943, and the Amagiri was one of the finest class of destroyers in the world. At that point, by a circumstance, it had been reduced to escorting troop convoys to the beleaguered Japanese garrison on Kalambangara. Some people, particularly Westerners, will analogize New Guinea to the Eastern Front of the Pacific theater of war. Obviously, the most direct analogy for the Eastern Front or the Russian Front of the Germans in the Pacific theater of conflict, or rather the East Asian theater of conflict, would, of course, be China. That is not often dealt with in American or Western histories. In fact, it's entirely ignored. So the closest thing that Americans have to conceive of a Russian front for the Japanese is New Guinea. It was said by the Japanese that no one ever returns alive from New Guinea. It was, of course, known as a meat grinder for the Americans as well. It was the only time they confronted the Japanese army head on. On the islands, of course, predominantly they were encountering naval infantry or Japanese Marines. So there was very little Japanese army presence in the Pacific. It was all in China. And so the only time they encountered the Japanese as army units was in New Guinea. And of course, the Americans faced such a beating, as well as the Australians and everyone else, though the Japanese ultimately fought to annihilation. The Americans under MacArthur made the statement, "No more Bunas." That was the precedent to no more Koreas, to no more Vietnams. That was how disastrous the campaign was in terms of loss of manpower for the Americans, that it became publicly unbearable. And they had to make excuses or bumper sticker sound bites like that so the American public would go on tolerating the war. That gives you some idea of how bad it was, considering this was World War II, and the Americans were maddened by war hysteria. And, of course, had locked their fellow Americans of Japanese, German, and Italian descent, many of them, all of them who were Japanese, into internment camps, and were quite prepared and ultimately would have killed them all had they not lost the war. Now, basically, the Amagiri on that night when they rammed President John F. Kennedy's PT boat had encountered American cruisers and destroyers in the month beforehand on a similar run, wherein they had lost 10 of their crew. So their officers and men wanted to make full speed that night, and they had just started the 400-mile run for Rabaul in the darkness of Blackett Strait when Amagiri's lookout spotted something small dead ahead, most likely an American PT boat. So Amagiri's helmsman sped right for it and rammed the small boat, smashing it to bits. However, most of the PT-109 survived, including her skipper, Lieutenant John F. Kennedy. Kennedy swam to shore, got a message out for rescue, carved on a coconut, literally, and survived, later writing a book about his naval career and rising to be president of the United States. Now, by March of 1944, several years later, Amagiri was assigned to the Southwest Area Fleet operating out of Singapore. And on April 20th of that year, she departed Singapore, escorting Awaba and Oi, she struck a mine in the Makassar Strait, 55 miles south of Balikpapan. Took 2 hours to sink while Aoba removed her crew. And the captain of that ship was later invited personally by John F. Kennedy to sit in the very important person seats, the VIP seats, as a personally invited individual, Lieutenant Commander Koyanami. And he was someone who was President Kennedy's personal guest for Kennedy being sworn in as President of the United States. That's because President Kennedy knew that had he probably not been rammed and survived that ramming, he probably would have died later on in the war. And so in that sense, the captain of that boat saved his life and enabled him to become president. And so Lieutenant Commander Koyanami is visible in photographs of Kennedy being sworn in as president. So that's important to know, because at that point, John F. Kennedy knew so much about the war, that's why he made the statement that he did ultimately by 1962 about not the lie being the enemy of truth, but the myth, which is something people want to believe. People want to believe everything that is false about World War II. So let's get into what exactly was so important about the war that made it so hard for people to understand. Who decides when a war is over? In 1945, Emperor Hirohito overcame a military coup to deliver the radio broadcast that Americans are told ended World War II. And that's what gives us the August 15th date for the end of the war, aside from the many other dates that are given for the end of the war. Some of them say September 2nd. Some of them say at the time of the dropping of the Nagasaki bomb. There is no surrender, so these dates are ad hoc and they're made up. They just roll off the tongue of the propagandist. And you can confirm this yourself by looking up when did World War II end in Japan. And you're not going to find anything that's accurate. And obviously, when you look up what I tell you, that the war ended in 1952 with the signing of the Japanese-American peace treaty, you realize what everything's saying is a load of shit anyway. Now, integral to said agenda, it's widely propagandized in popular American accounts that God Emperor Dr. Hirohito personally intervened in the surrender negotiations in Tokyo. There's no evidence whatsoever that he did so. Even the best, some might say the only source, that it was not recorded after ceasefire and hence liable to distortions in the face of said ceasefire conditions as demanded by the Japanese themselves. The diary of Hirohito Sensei Tenno's most trusted advisor, Lord Privy Seal Maki Kido Koichi, Lord Keeper of the Privy Seal, who played a crucial role in arranging the God Emperor's sacred decisions at the imperial conferences, does not depict the God Emperor of the Japanese actively intervening to promote any peace. Sometime earlier, General George C. Marshall had asked Major General Leslie Groves of the Atomic Bomb Project, director of America's entire nuclear program, of the plutonium bomb, which is why the calculations were different. Americans knew that the Germans had blown the bomb at Kurland, an atomic bomb, a uranium bomb, but what they were producing was a plutonium bomb. They actually interpreted this via alchemical means, the alchemical concept of the creation and destruction of primordial matter. That's why you have an occultist, Oppenheimer, actually quoting the goddess Kali, saying, "I am become death, the shatterer of worlds," because he is completing a ritual of cosmic destruction in which he himself becomes God. Then General Leslie Groves becomes God, and they become as unto gods because they felt the world was going to end. They felt they would destroy the world by a plutonium bomb and do what the uranium bomb could not do, destroy planet Earth completely and destroy God's creation and all mankind created in his image, which would make them gods fit to be the recreators of a new universe in the face and shape of their anti-gods, the gods of the Cthulhu mythos, as warned about by H.P. Lovecraft, who was, of course, assassinated via injection of cancer in a hospital. Now, all of that, of course, I've gone into great detail in the past, the technical aspects of that. Carcinogens as an assassination weapon, they have been deployed as such. They were certainly employed against Hugo Chavez of Venezuela, at that point in history, already being aerosolized. Now, Groves' report, responding to General George C. Marshall, it reached Marshall on July 30th of 1945. Each bomb, the same size as would be used against Hiroshima, Groves wrote, could wipe out enemy resistance over an area of 2,000 feet in diameter, paralyze it over an area a mile in diameter, and seriously hinder it over an area 5 miles in diameter. Blast effect would kill soldiers in slit trenches within 800 feet of the explosion, but troops sheltering in deep caves a mile or so from ground zero would survive to fight. Now, what he's doing is he's tactically analyzing the deployment of uranium bombs as developed by the scores by the Japanese and by the dozens by the Germans. So on July 31st, less than a week prior to the U.S. atomic terror attack on Hiroshima, Hirohito Ishiteno, Emperor Hirohito, made clear to Lord Privy Seal Makikito that the imperial regalia of Japan had to be defended at all costs. Preservation of the Kokutai, the Japanese imperial polity of all power descending from the emperor and extending to the emperor, implied not only that of the imperial institution, but also the continuity of God Emperor Dr. Hirohito's own personal reign over the Japanese nation. So God Emperor Hirohito, a PhD, was still goading Soviet response at that time through non-committal Japanese peace feelers to basically bait them into invading Manchuria so he could draw them and their T-32s, which were hot rods on open fields, but became death traps in Korean mountain passes. He was leading them into the non-mobile trap of the Korean peninsula where they would choke and essentially wind up being obliterated by the atomic landmines, the uranium shells, as detonated by the Japanese. And, of course, he was making no move to change his own government position. This is, of course, referenced in Lord Privy Kido Kuichi, the diary of Makikito's book, Selected Translations into English, published, I believe, by Frederick Maryland University Publications of America. Now, indeed, God Emperor Dr. Hirohito actively sought the final battle. His military was preparing under his direct command because he knew he would win. And, of course, this can be verified by reading sources such as Herbert P. Bix. I'm refraining from Japanese authors or writers because Americans trust only white people. And, of course, if they say it's a Japanese writer, they're just going to say, it's just a yellow gook who's propagandizing the gook position. So fuck you, whitey. Here's some white boy for you who wrote an article called Japan's Delayed Surrender, a Reinterpretation. That's collected in Michael J. Hogan, the editor's Hiroshima in History and Memory. Now, it's common knowledge that Japan objected only to ceasing proactive prosecution of hostilities unconditionally, a rather common misconception, thereby abdicating its emperorship, and the United States insisted on demanding those terms. Now, the opening month of 1945, January, saw Emperor Hirohito hold an imperial conference during which His Divine Majesty authorized Minister Togo to notify the Allies through General Douglas MacArthur himself, who was considered a celebrity warrior whose projection of Caesarian authority Hirohito had come to admire and who apparently reminded him in some manner of his original mentor, General Nogi. as MacArthur was the only prominent United States high officer descendant of multi-generational military lineage, and thereby the closest that American culture had ever come to producing something comparable to a scion of samurai nobility. One of Hirohito's primary ceasefire demands was the presence of General Douglas MacArthur in his court to serve liaison between His Imperial Majesty and the United States executive. And of course, it was also obvious that Hirohito perceived MacArthur to be an egotistically manipulable savant or idiot savant. And Japan would accept their terms on one condition, that the declaration does not comprise any demand which prejudices the prerogatives of His Majesty as sovereign ruler. In other words, Emperor Hirohito remained in charge completely and totally. General Douglas MacArthur, of course, would be the figurehead. Now, General Douglas MacArthur himself forwarded this Japanese offer directly to the president, Harry Truman, by which to conditionally terminate proactive prosecution of hostilities on the exact terms which the United States was forced to accept 7 months into the future after Franklin Delano Roosevelt's death. Now, General Douglas MacArthur himself would later contend that Japan would have accepted this conditional peace before America's commitment to atomic terrorism if the United States had but notified Japan it would accept a surrender, quote-unquote, that acceded to Emperor Hirohito retaining his position as constitutional leader of Japan. Again, a condition the United States was in fact forced to acquiesce to upon its own suing for peace. Now, U.S. leadership cross-confirmed the reality of such through Brigadier General Clark's intercepts of encoded Japanese messages, but obstinately refused to express any willingness on Washington's part to accept the single condition, as it was well understood that Hirohito himself was the singular supreme source of Japan's strategic successes, a military genius of Napoleonic proportions, considered far too dangerous a threat to be allowed to live. Nevertheless, Michael D. Gordon, the author of 5 Days in August, How World War II Became a Nuclear War, among many other investigators, exposit how President Truman had been informed through Swiss and Portuguese channels, among many others, of Japanese peace overtures as early as 3 months prior to the Hiroshima bombing. Now, on July 25th of 1945, the Potsdam Declaration was issued, demanding the unconditional surrender of Japan and threatening complete destruction if this was not done. The Allies' Potsdam Declaration had been silent on the exact way the emperor would be treated, although it was clear they wanted a change to the system of government. The Japanese first offered peace with conditions straight after the Potsdam Declaration, the only condition being that they attached the emperor would be protected. The USA refused to accept this Japanese offer. Had these demands been accepted as offered in the months prior to America's atomic terrorist attacks, there would have been no heavy loss of life of Americans as well as Japanese on either Kita Iwotoshima, or North Sulphur Island, bastardized as Iwoshima in English, Iwo Jima, and that resulted in 26,000 Americans killed or wounded, approximately 21,000 Japanese killed, far less than the Americans died, more Americans died than Japanese there, I remind you, or the deaths that would happen on Okinawa Island, which resulted in American battle casualties totaling 49,151 exactly per their own official body count. Japanese death toll was given is 109,000 counted dead, plus an estimated 24,000 in the closed caves buried by American demolitions intentionally. Now, since the number was far above the estimated Japanese forces of military on the island, per Army intelligence, it is supposed to this day that about 42,000 were civilians. Now, we need to compare this to the atomic bombs, because what the Americans don't tell you is Okinawans were being raped, butchered, and cannibalized by American Marines, who would take infants and literally put them on spits through the anus that would emerge from their mouths and put them over an open roasting flame alive and then take big bites out of them. This is a fact. This is a fact. Because of the fate like this and because of women being eaten alive while they were being raped, this is all true. Because Americans did not consider Japanese to be human, so they ate them as animals. Now, they ate them instead of the many pigs that were on the island, because the Americans slaughtered all the pigs in intent to starve the Okinawans when winter came, that the rest of the Okinawans would die. One of the primary victory conditions of Emperor Hirohito was that the Americans were forced to ship all kinds of pigs to Iwo Jima, because the Americans had killed every single pig on Iwo Jima. Okinawa. The people of Okinawa are of Sinitic descent. They are like Vietnamese or Chinese. They are not ethnically Japanese. they are Japanese acculturated. They are an entirely separate ethnicity. They have their own national flag. You can look this up. There is an Okinawan, or rather Ryukyu's island flag, of which Okinawa is the capital of the Ryukyu's island chain. So the Okinawans, unlike Japanese, ate pork. And the Japanese, of course, were vegetarian. They ate fish, but were vegetarian. They were not vegan, mind you, for all the idiots out there who don't understand the concept. So the Okinawans were viewed by the Japanese with some level of cultural contempt because of their meat eating. They would view the Okinawans the same way Muslims would look at people who eat pork, or Jews would look at people who eat pork. So the Okinawans, however, were not left defenseless. The Japanese defended them as well as they could. But once the Japanese garrisons were wiped out, the Okinawan civilians were basically being eaten alive by Americans. Now, to avoid this fate, Okinawans began to kill themselves. And far more Okinawans killed themselves on Okinawa than Japanese were to die in the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki combined. Very important fact to remember. Now, had those demands been accepted as offered, there would have been none of that. There would have been no firebombing of Japanese cities by B-29 bombers. It's estimated that the saturation of 1,700 tons of incendiary explosives on Japanese cities during March 9th through the 10th alone killed over 80,000 civilians, destroyed 200 and some 60,000 structures. No American commitment to atomic terrorism, which initially killed about 200,000 Japanese, and many other ethnicities, as I've mentioned on my other transmission before this, with the inevitable retaliatory brinkmanship that followed to close the war in Japanese favor. None of that would have happened. Throughout all of this, the Japanese tried at least three more American recognized times. At least, there were many more than that that the Americans will not even officially recognize, attempts being made by the Japanese to negotiate peace. But of the three times that the Americans officially recognized, two of these times were via the Russians. The Japanese government also offered conditional peace by radio broadcast. Again, the leaders of the government of the USA refused to talk about, pretended they only wanted an unconditional surrender. In the final result, the single and only condition the Japanese had ever asked for in peace was protection of the emperor, which was in fact honored by the United States anyway. So the firebombing killed well over 100,000 people in Japan from February of 1945 on, directly and indirectly, was entirely unnecessary. None of that needed to happen. That intensive conventional bombing would have continued prior to an invasion as well. Complementary operation against Japan's railways was already commencing, the operational objective being the isolation of southern cities, such as the ancient Japanese capital of Kyoto and the immense metropolitan sprawl of Osaka Kobe, of the core island of Honshu from the food grown elsewhere in the home islands. The actual secreted American military intention was the total eradication of Caucasian allied POWs, British, Dutch, American, Russian, numbering over 100,000 white people, all male, all prisoners of war, some female nurses who were white, and the Americans want to kill them all in order to prevent their continuity as a resource to the Japanese that spoke foreign languages. And, of course, as an ongoing and readily cross-referenced source of voluminous amounts of exploitable information in any way imaginable, as well, not to mention being a vast labor pool of physically larger and stronger workers than what the Japanese were. So, indeed, the submarine blockade and the United States Army Air Force's mining operation, all too rudely codenamed Operation Starvation, were both intended to totally cut off Japan's import, precepts that her higher command would be forced to choose between feeding their own native population or continuing to maintain this priceless resource of foreign man or woman and brain power altogether of foreign whites. The American high command was betting on precedent. Logistically isolated Japanese held islands were garrisoned by staffs that had been forced to resort to cannibalizing their Caucasian allied POWs to ward off mass starvation when choked off from resupply. The Pentagon was banking on the Japanese literally being pushed into eating their investment and thereby denying themselves an invaluable asset population. But unknown to the Americans, the Japanese War Ministry had already preempted their enemies' planning processes on basis of their ongoing quarantine campaigns in the Pacific, where the majority of Japanese garrison islands had never been invaded but simply cut off from supply lines wherever possible. So, alas, on August 1st of 1944, that decisive month, imperial orders were issued instructing the mass execution and disposal of all Allied POWs if an invasion of the Japanese main islands were ever to occur, the logic motivating said orders being that mass last breakouts of Caucasian POWs attempting runs towards any established Allied beachheads and our lines could cause incalculable chaos behind Japanese lines. So, 73 years and 12 days ago, on the morning of August 6, 1945, the B-29 Superfortress Enola Gay dropped an atomic bomb on Hiroshima. A short time later, other B-29s began dropping leaflets on Tokyo, stating, because your military leaders have rejected the 13-part surrender declaration, we have employed our atomic bomb. Before we use this bomb again and again to destroy every resource of the military by which they are prolonging this useless war, petition the emperor now to end the war. Now, there was no way that Japanese civilians could petition Emperor Hirohito to accept the terms of the July 26 Potsdam Declaration outlining the Allies' surrender demands. Among them, the complete disarmament of Japanese forces and the elimination for all time the authority and influence of those who have deceived and misled the people of Japan into embarking on world conquest. Well, talk about projection. Well, all those who write on this subject, the Americanists, and what I find interesting in all this revisionist thesis of the Americans is that the Japanese have no agency in their own history. But then we come to nuance, because these leaflets reflected a nigh universally perceived unreality that only the emperor could end the war. Now, Emperor Hirohito, even though he won the war, was not the man who ended it. Now, of course, one of the things that I need to emphasize is, of course, that over 90% of the Imperial Japanese Army was actively advancing on offensive in China at the time of the Americans going nuclear on the very day of the Hiroshima terror attack. August 6, 1945, General George C. Marshall received a special War Department analysis revealing that Japan had activated no less than 42 divisions in the last 7 months, 23 inside of Japan itself, and was contemporarily mobilizing even more, 65 additional infantry and 5 armored divisions by time of America's planned invasion. Japan had only just begun to fight, this monumental mass mobilization being the very reason why so few, if any, able-bodied Japanese men were to perish via strategic bombing, either conventional or nuclear. As I said, Dr. Nishina was flown to Hiroshima after the atomic attack. His Geiger counter readings were coded and radioed to Tokyo, where Dr. Sagani underscored his confirmation of the American escalation of war to nuclear levels, and of course his calculations that were that if all the American refining facilities and power plants could be devoted exclusively to yielding fissionable materials, if allowed to operate 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for 3 years, they would be able to produce 2 or maybe 3 atomic bombs. And the first nuclear device, called Gadget, had already been detonated during the Trinity occult ritual in an attempt to destroy the world at New Mexico. So Japan knew the enemy had wasted one plutonium bomb in testing via their offshore submarine-launched aerial reconnaissance and radiation-sensitive balloon trades. And their physics community concluded that after Hiroshima, if they had not already made certain that America was out of domestically produced atomic bombs, they only had one more left in their domestic nuclear arsenal. Now, there's plenty of these calculations didn't factor in. About 300 troy ounces of captured German uranium refined to nearly 10% purity of U-235. But, of course, the kami, or gods of Japan, were watching over their own. They balanced against these recent plutonium and uranium gains because the Americans had all kinds of things that went wrong. All of the world's known refined plutonium produced in the United States was in a test tube held by a white trash piece of shit named Don Mastic, who basically, when he was holding it, somehow the vial cracked open, burst open, and produced a cloud of plutonium, all the known plutonium the United States had ever produced in written human history, and he inhaled it in a panic. He sucked in, and all the world's uranium went into his lungs. That dumb motherfucker lived to be about 80, 90 years old. Anyhow, what they had to do was they had to get all of it out of his intestines by giving him a bunch of laxatives and have him shit it out. I'm not making this up. This isn't urban legend. This is not like some Douglas Dietrich anecdote. All of this is historically verifiable. You can look up Don Mastic, M-A-S-T-I-C-K. White trash piece of shit, lived to be almost 100 years old thanks to this. They made him shit and boiled all the shit to get the plutonium back up. The smell was so horrible, it made all of the Manhattan Project stink. The entire city at Los Alamos could smell it all day long. Him shitting and they're burning his shit. On a petition that was signed by all the physicists and everybody in the city, what they did was they got rid of him by as soon as the Americans invaded Tiananmen Island, They flew him over as the first civilian colonist of Tiananmen Island so that he could complete his shitting over there and they could get all the plutonium out of it and then re-put it into the guts of the bomb. This is why the bomb parts arrived disassembled, was because they had to get all of the plutonium out of this guy's intestines. So when it was finally dropped in a panic over Nagasaki, it had been through Don Mastic's intestinal chute. Every single ounce of plutonium that was the incendiary within the triggering mechanism, the primary explosive, if you will, within the fat man. Now, of course, basically a fourth domestically manufactured American bomb would not be ready until mid-September of 1945 by Japanese calculations. Realistically, not until October. Reality dictated so. The Sagani Hotohiki, the Sagani equations told it so in spite of the inevitable intelligence voids. One bomb tested, another bomb deployed at Hiroshima for the duration of the strategic window of opportunity open for Japan in the critical month or two ahead. Only the third bomb remained, which, of course, General Hata, the field marshal of the Japanese army who survived dead center the ground zero of the Hiroshima bombing, went before his god emperor to argue that Japan could absorb a third atomic attack. No problem. That fact gave Japan a four-month, a 120-day strategic window of opportunity to deploy their own, entirely unanticipated by the Americans, weapons of mass destruction against America's homeland and her forces afield. This never even factored into American calculations until it was too late. So on August 10th, well, basically, of course, on August 9th, the Nagasaki bomb was dropped, of course, and what you had was a situation in which simultaneously the Sacred Crane Task Force of super dirigibles, which had been launched on the day of the Hiroshima bombing, reached America on the day of the Nagasaki bombing. The ultimatum was presented to America. This was not, of course, the entire inventory of Japanese doomsday weapons. All the majority of those, of which the Sacred Crane Task Force presented but a sample for Americans to analyze to get an idea of the enormity of what they were contending with in terms of the potential for extermination. All of that, the majority of these weapons of mass destruction that Japan would use in this four-month window were basically in China. And, of course, it was my government, the Nationalist Republic of China, which helped the Japanese maintain this. That was what saved our government, enabled us to relocate to Taiwan, which was granted to us as a gift by Emperor Hirohito himself. And, of course, that's what made us sacrifice our position as a member of the United Nations Security Council, why we're considered the last Axis nation on the surface of the earth. Now, of course, on August 10th, the day after the bomb was dropped on Nagasaki, a message came from Tokyo accepting the terms of the Potsdam Declaration with the understanding said declaration didn't compromise any demand which prejudiced the prerogatives of His Majesty as sovereign ruler. And, of course, the term understanding was used because Japan had already been offering this peace condition for months despite the USA leadership's refusal to accept it under any administration to that point. Now, this is, of course, conditional. Unconditional means no conditions. Now, there's two versions of the official, quote-unquote, instrument of surrender document, known to the Japanese as an instrument of peace. The public one that is always cited in support of the claim that the surrender was unconditional, the one that's used by the Americans in all your history books and all your photographs, that's entirely illegitimate and illegal because it lacks the seal of the emperor, which means it's not an actual document. It's like the forged documents that are produced by the gang stalkers who say I wasn't in the military or that my father wasn't in the military. All of these documents being forged. So it's, for all intents and purposes, a forged document. And the image of the pacifist Hirohito, Japan's quote-unquote symbolic monarch, by an analogy to the British crown, is entirely a post-ceasefire creation generated to placate the American public by the same duplicitous federal government under military junta, which had misled the Americans into war. Now, consider the circumstances that surrounded the meeting of the Supreme War Council. And, of course, what happened was you had a period of time when both the Soviet entry into the Greater East Asian War and the abortive atomic attack on Japan's Kokura National Armory, which became the Nagasaki bombing, destined to be diverted onto that civilian city only a matter of hours away, the meeting was canceled because one of the council's members had more important business elsewhere. It's difficult to discern any matter that could have represented more important business than consideration of the question of the Japanese nation's immediate and unconditional surrender from an American perspective, excepting from a Japanese perspective, they had to deal with imperial coordination of immediate and or ultimate victory. So between the Hiroshima attack of August 6th, the Nagasaki attack on August 9th, the U.S. Chief of Staff George Catlin Marshall was advised by the head of Army Intelligence that the atomic bombs were not expected to be of any strategic significance, redirecting him back to his original conceptualization of their deployment as a tactical weapon in America's abortive scheme to invade Japan, Operation Downfall. Now, Seaman, who was involved, S-E-E-M-A-N, you can look this gentleman up, he was involved with America's Operation Downfall planning, confirmed that the blast effect of the bombs would clear the beaches while U.S. soldiers and Marines stayed about 6 miles offshore. The invaders would land 2 or 3 days later. Hall knew another atomic attack against the city would simply galvanize Japanese spiritual mobilization, as the Americans termed it, further and render any surrender in any form impossible. Like the rest of the American high command, however, he was prepared for a permanent war of racial extermination, not only as inevitable, but welcome. America's warlords had never dreamed of the American public so willingly giving them such totalitarian powers, and they wallowed in their intent to extend this power play forever. For George C. Marshall, the only professional soldier ever to win the Nobel Peace Prize, the tactical use of atomic bombs to support the invasion was primed for Kyushu, the main southern island of Japan, was seen as the only realistic alternative to the continued pounding of Japanese cities, and in this he was simply aping his enemies, as the Axis had already deployed atomic ordnance in operational context to great effect at Kurland, Estonia, on the Baltic littoral, where they disintegrated the Soviets and were able to conduct, therefore, the largest mass migration, the largest mass evacuation of humanity in recorded history, Operation Hannibal, under control of the German Navy, where 1 million German Aryans were rescued. Thus, when Adolf Hitler deployed his atomic bomb, you can accurately say Adolf Hitler rescued 1 million lives. Now, the very reason there were 3 atomic bomb assembly structures on Tiananmen, where Don Mastic was shitting his brains out, along with 3 fully loaded stock rooms, 15 509th air crews with their special silver plate B-29 bombers, was so that atom bomb number 3, Fat Man Unit F-32, already on site Tiananmen, would be dropped on the Japanese National Arsenal of Kokura, the intended target of the original Fat Man plutonium bomb, by General Paul Tibbets himself, whenever its critical core components finally arrived, which he explained very incompletely upon reissue of his 1998 autobiography, The Flight of the Enola Gay. As the Nagasaki bombing fiasco had already proven conclusively that both the Japanese imperial family and that 2,600-year-old dynasty's industry were more than adequately entrenched enough to survive America's quote-unquote strategic approach to nuclear warfare. The domestically designed and developed American atomic ordnance, Fat Man, was dropped on Nagasaki in expeditious retreat during a failed attempt to deploy the USA-manufactured nuclear implosion gravity bomb codenamed Fat Man, this singular plutonium bomb with much more powerful yield than the Axis-manufactured and standardized little boy uranium shell, as so recently dropped over Hiroshima. Now, the United States' contrivance is that Nagasaki had deliberately not been subjected to large-scale bombing to that point. The reality was the fact that it was. Americans were bombing schools, orphanages, specifically any place where children were located in an attempt to break morale. Now, on the morning of August 9th in 1945, the mission plan for the terrorist attack on Kokura in the Urakami province was nearly identical to that of the Hiroshima mission, with 2 B-29s flying an hour ahead as weather scouts. Observers aboard the weather planes reported target clear. Now, this is very important. Target clear. All clear weather. When Major Charles W. Sweeney's aircraft, the U.S. 393rd Squadron B-29 Super Fortress Boxcar, arrived at the assembly point for his flight off the coast of Japan. The third plane, flown by Group's Operations Officer, Lieutenant Colonel James Hopkins, failed to make rendezvous. It's hard to imagine someone showing up late for a war, but the 509th were pampered favorites. Boxcar and her accompanying instrumentation plane circled for 40 minutes without locating Hopkins. Already 30 minutes behind schedule, Sweeney decided to fly on without Hopkins. Now, the crew of the Boxcar failed to bomb Japan's National Arsenal after 3 unsuccessful bomb runs in 45 minutes of flight time. And they said, due to inclement weather. Now, there was no fucking inclement weather. There wasn't a single goddamn cloud imposing any 710 cloud cover, which allegedly obscured the city of Kokura and prohibited visual attack. You're fucking dropping an atomic bomb, a nuclear weapon. You don't need to aim. It's a claim which flies in the face of the physical presence of Navy Commander Frederick Ashworth
aboard to specifically expedite a radar approach over aiming point anyway. So the officially contrived storyline that contradicts the recorded B-29 Weather Scout reconnaissance report of target Claire has since been propagated by the 509th gang themselves as part of an aggressive revision campaign to perpetuate the myth that the Americans were bombing Japan with total impunity, an inter-services promotional fantasy fabricated to reinforce the assertion that America's submarine campaign had completely isolated the Japanese home islands from supplying enough fuel by which to dispatch even a single interceptor to confront American aerial terrorism. Now, in the course of assembling atom bombs, the top secret inside story of Little Boy and Fat Man, published by John Coster Mullen, you've got thousands of pages of declassified documents and photographs. He traveled well in excess of 100,000 miles around the world to inspect, measure, photograph over a dozen Little Boy and Fat Man weapon casings at nine different museums. He attended the 509th Composite Atomic Bombers military reunions. He conducted hundreds of hours of interviews with Manhattan Project, 509th Composite Group, Project Alberta veterans. And in 2001, the surviving members of the 509th Composite Group voted to make Atomic John Coster Mullen a permanent honorary member of the 509th Bomber Group. And he's attended almost every reunion of this organization since 1994. Now, he created a full-scale exact replica of Little Boy for permanent display at the historic Wendover Airfield Museum. And before final delivery to Wendover, it was signed by all the surviving members of the 509th at their 2004 reunion in Wichita. I've personally spoken to Coster Mullen multiple times in the past. He eventually served as co-chairman of the 509th's 2007 reunion in Chicago. Now, he is considered one of the leading experts of the mission, and in all the interviews he conducted with the navigator, Sweeney's two co-pilots, the flight engineers, basically what happened was, of course, they encountered vicious interception and Japanese planes that put a bullet hole in their bomb bay, at which point they said, oh, man, we can't drop this with impunity. We're under fire. We got to get the hell out. And so basically what had happened was that in the span of these abortive attempts, Bokhtar's flight engineer discovered a major malfunction, NASA Space Shuttle Challenger style. And basically he said that enemy rounds had been delivered into Bokhtar via Japan's non-existent air defense, quote unquote. And somehow this ghost air force was able to fire a bullet into the fuel pump, which had ceased functioning, and trapped 600 gallons of fuel, highly inflammable aviation fuel, in the auxiliary bomb bay fuel tanks, rendering it unavailable for use, and Iwo Jima's airfield was closed, and the crew couldn't transfer the Fat Man to another B-29 because of that closure of the Iwo Jima airfield. And, of course, now you've got the bomb soaking in highly flammable aviation fuel, and at that point everybody realized, oh, we're not just killing people. We could actually die ourselves. So in a panic retreat, Commander W. Sweeney opted to drop the single most powerful weapon in American inventory over Nagasaki. What happened is that he couldn't, drop it out to sea because they were afraid it would blow. They had to drop it immediately, and the closest place was Nagasaki. Now, that destroyed everything, meaning it destroyed American plans, because Nagasaki's geography played a major role in limiting Fat Man's effectiveness. It dissipated 80% of the plutonium bomb's power by confining the explosion to the bowl-shaped valley amidst the Nagasaki hills, and thus prevented casualties, fatalities, and material damages from becoming nearly as extensive as those produced by the much lower-yield Little Boy over Hiroshima. So Japan's Asahi Shimbun estimates there are maybe 135,000 for Nagasaki, including diseases from the after effects based on hospital data that ultimately died. And, of course, this was all part of carrying out massive civilian casualties. But what really happened was well over 2,500 young ladies employed in Mitsubishi Grupo's, the Mitsubishi Group's underground bunkered production facilities beneath the city of Nagasaki survived deployment of this most powerful weapon in American inventory without any awareness that an atomic attack had occurred overhead, continuing in their lead-lined bunkers with full industrial facilities going at full pace, unabated, full-scale assembly of Patsy long-range bombers capable of reaching New York City from Tokyo. Modeled on the prototype KI-77s produced in 1940 prior to Pearl Harbor, and it was concluded correctly that any atomic attack at that point on the Japanese national capital of Tokyo would leave the imperial bunkers equally unscathed. So what you had was, by the time that Sweeney returned to his commander, Mr. Blood and Guts Curtis LeMay, basically he said that when he finally got to meet him after that mission, that Curtis LeMay didn't even return his salute, just said, "You missed the target." And at that time, he knew his entire career was over. So what you have was a situation where all of these industries that Japan was producing that would produce bombers that would reach New York City, not San Francisco. We're talking about the other end of the American continent, because they had pressurized cabins. They were essentially stratospheric. Basically, that was going on full scale, and now America was going to be on the receiving end of atomic bombing. Now, there was already discussion in the United States War Department about conserving the bombs in production until Operation Downfall, the projected invasion of Japan, had begun. A definitive revelation of the fact the United States High Command recognized the total failure of their strategic deployment of nuclear weapons is evidenced by further projected deployments of atomic ordnance through the future being relegated to operational level utilization and beachhead establishment for the intended exterminatory invasion of the Japanese home islands, which was never realized. So when news of the Nagasaki bombing came on August 9th, the Supreme War Direction Council reacted not by moving toward peace, but by declaring martial law throughout Japan. Following the bombing of Nagasaki, the Japanese government met several times to discuss peace negotiations. Of course, there were sharp divisions amidst the ranks as whether they should accept the Allied ultimatum or fight on. And since the U.S. was reading all the Japanese secret diplomatic messages, they having broken the diplomatic codes before Pearl Harbor, they had an almost real-time understanding of the complexity of the Japanese position. Now, concurrent with the Second World War, there was a covert organization known only as KYŪJŌ-INBŌ-JIKEN, the Golden Lily. It was established to organize the looting of gold throughout the Orient. And, of course, it was a highly organized military, medical, industrial effort because much of this gold was being processed into monatomic aurum potable monotonic, MAPM, for ingestion to prolong life. Now, the KYŪJŌ-INBŌ-JIKEN teams perpetrated looting on a massive scale. They systematically emptied treasuries, banks, factories, private residences, temples, churches, mosques, museums, pawn shops, art galleries, stripping ordinary people of what little they had. Even as Dai Nippon, Greater Japan's top Yakuza, samurai mafia gangsters, looted Asia's underworld and its black economy. And the inventory of stolen property is reportedly inclusive of gems, golden Buddhas, private numismatic or coin collections, assorted precious metals of immense value. Not since the Spaniards had conquered Tenwantinsuyu, the Inca Empire, back in 1532, had the world seen such an aggressively thorough looting campaign to transport plunder safely and efficiently back to the conqueror's homeland in this uninterrupted river of golden riches. Now, the KYŪJŌ-INBŌ-JIKEN had been assembled under innovation of Emperor Hirohito. And to head the KYŪJŌ-INBŌ-JIKEN Enterprise's systematic plunder of Asia, Hirohito appointed none other than his brother, the former officer of the 1st Imperial Guards Division with frontal combat command experience against the Soviet war machine in Manchuria. And his brother was English-speaking, native speaker fluency in the King's English, just as Hirohito himself was. And, of course, he was a member of several secret orders, including the British Order of the Seraphim, that was the Swedish Order of the Seraphim, the British Order of the Grand Cross of the Royal Victorian Order. He also was a member of that. And he was promoted to Major Generalcy prior official retirement from the conventional Imperial Japanese Army, upon which he's propagandized to have withdrawn from public life to convalesce as a tuberculetic. All of this, of course, betrayed, its cover is blown in retrospect by his acknowledged repute for post-war pursuit of personal participation in multiple sporting pastimes. Now, in reality, he became actively involved from that point forward, acquiring Buddhist votive gold from Burma, British gold from Singapore, French gold from Saigon, etc., shipping all the plunder to the Philippines, where he supervised slave labor to bury it at 172 sites. So we're getting to how that's important for what Hirohito said to his command when we return, because, of course, Hirohito was financing his own private war where his military was proving less than competent of carrying out his orders.
when the Americans threatened the Filipino archipelago, Emperor Hirohito's brother, the PMG, the Princely Major General Yasuhito Chichibu, ordered over a dozen Nipponjin or Japanese warships scuttled, that means sunk, with gold cargoes in green waters, that means shallow waters, and they had their crews machine gunned to prevent their potential capture by the Americans and or disclosures of said sites under American torture. Now, by August of 1945, Princely Major General Yasuhito Chichibu had been pseudonymously redeployed to Dainippon Teikoku Chosen, the Greater Imperial Japanese Peninsula of Korea, known in the Korean as Ilje Gangjamji. This was an annexed dependency of Dainippon Teikoku, the Greater Japanese Empire. And he was redeployed there under false persona to evade identification whilst commanding the nuclear detonative generation of today's Korean Demilitarized Zone via the simultaneous detonation of multiple uranium shells all along the Korean Peninsula from sea to sea, and simultaneously destroying his old enemy, the Soviets, and their advance into the Japanese Empire itself. Now, like all members of the Kazuko no Yamato, the family Yamato of the Imperial Dynasty of Japan, he was exonerated from criminal prosecutions before the Tokyoto Tribunal by the Emperor's General, Gaijin Shogun Dalgarasu Asa Makasatora, the barbarian Generalissimo Douglas Arthur MacArthur, who was considered, of course, Emperor Hirohito's hired mercenary. He himself was later recognized as a traitor by his own nation, bought by Golden Lily Lucre, and relieved of his command, fired by his President Truman for a collaboration with the enemy court of Yamato in time of war. Now, basically, what Emperor Hirohito was saying at the time that he was speaking to many of his men in the bunker that many Americans always source as exemplary of Hirohito trying to surrender is basically when he speaks to them, the direct quote from the primary point of his discussion, or rather his orders to his men all around him, is quoted here by me as translated from the Japanese. The decision I have reached is akin to the one forced upon my grandfather, the Emperor Meiji. I say it once more, as he endured the unbearable, so shall I, and so must you. Nevertheless, the time has come when we must bear the unbearable, when I recall the feelings of my imperial grandsire, the Emperor Meiji, at the time of the Sengoku Tensho, the tripartite intervention of 1895. The triple intervention was a diplomatic intervention by Russia, Germany, and France on April 23rd of 1895 over the terms of the Treaty of Shimonoseki, signed between the Imperial Japanese and the Qing Dynasty that ended the First Sino-Japanese War. The Japanese reaction against the triple intervention was one of the underlying causes of the subsequent Russo-Japanese War, where the Japanese defeated Russia. So what he is speaking of was that they're going to have to prepare for a direct contact with the barbarians, as happened at that time. This would potentially mean invasion, or it would potentially mean the Americans would come there to rebuild and reconstruct under his demands. So if it came to that, he said, I swallow my tears and give my sanction to the proposal to accept the Allied proclamation on the basis outlined by the foreign minister. Now, he's saying all this to appease the men around him that he regrets doing this, but he's also telling them that basically to get everything done right, I've had to do everything myself. That's because much of the other speech, which I'm not going to read to you, because, of course, it's very long, his discussion with the men in the bomb shelter around the time of August 9th, at the time of the Nagasaki bombing through August 10th. Most of that is talking about various deployments of divisions, facts that divisions have not been raised or deployed where he expected them. He's basically, in his very soft-spoken manner, admonishing his generals as incompetent. And basically what he's telling them is, to get everything done right, I've had to do everything myself. Meaning he's had to loot all of Asia to finance his own private war and his secret air force to destroy the Americans, and his secret navy, his submarine force, his undersea force. It wasn't a surface navy, but a submarine fleet to destroy the Americans using submarine-launched air power. All of this he had to do himself. So on August 10th, as he said, I swallow my tears and give my sanction to the proposal to accept Allied proclamation on the basis outlined by the foreign minister. That's why the next day on August 10th, the Japanese foreign ministry transmitted a telegram response to the Allies, apparently offering to accept the terms of the Potsdam Declaration, but not the full unconditional surrender the Allies sought. Instead, understanding that those terms did not comprise any demand which prejudices the prerogatives of His Majesty as sovereign ruler. Now, there was much scope for interpretation in what the two sides wanted, and it would take 5 days for the Americans to damage, control, and spin what they were going to present to the American public. So during that period of time, they continued with all-out war for the face of the American public. On August 10th, Major General Leslie Groves, military director of the Manhattan Project, sent a memorandum to the General of the Army, George Marshall, the Chief of Staff of the United States Army, in which he wrote that the next bomb should be ready for delivery on the first suitable weather after the 17th or 18th of August. That would be the last bomb available. On that same day, Marshall endorsed the memo with the comment, "The problem now is whether or not to continue dropping them every time one is made and shipped out there, or whether to hold them and then pour them all in a reasonably short time, not all in one day, but over a short period. And that also takes into consideration the target that we are after. In other words, should we not concentrate on targets that will be of the greatest assistance to an invasion rather than industry, morale, psychology, and the like? All the untenables that have not produced any results, near the tactical use rather than other use." So already the strategic war, the nuclear war, had been lost. And yet in Washington, the retention of Hirohito as the ruler of Japan had already been agreed upon that 10th day in August. Come 1955, years later, Truman himself finally publicly posed the questions he had faced a decade earlier. Could we continue the emperor and yet expect to eliminate the warlike spirit in Japan? Of course not. That's why Japan has one of the largest navies in the world, second largest only to the United States. That's why Japan has one of the most powerful militaries in Asia. Well, that question's answered. And Truman asked, could we even consider a message with so large a but to the kind of unconditional surrender we had fought for? Well, you had to, because you were facing total extinction. Of course, he didn't talk about that, but in 1973, Margaret Truman, I believe that was his daughter or his wife, I can't remember which, added, he's white trash, so it's probably both, right? Anyhow, Margaret Truman, whichever she was, she said, "My father agreed," this is daughter, now that I read her quote here, I'm looking it up from the notes that I've got. She said, "My father agreed, but in a way that did not compromise his position, that the people of Japan must remain free to choose their own form of government." Yes, there we are. So what she was doing was basically stating the Americans had lost and they had to give the Japanese everything they wanted. So a full working week prior to Hirohito Ishoteno's very literal deadline, Allied bombing of Japan was halted on 11th August because of bad weather. Again, that inclement weather bullshit. And then the situation was confirmed to allow negotiations to continue. The talk-down processes had begun. And Japan received the Allied reply, including U.S. insistence that the authority of the emperor and the Japanese government to rule the state shall be subject to the supreme commander of the Allied powers, who would take such steps as he deems proper to effectuate the surrender terms. So they were already processing in MacArthur as the front man and the figurehead for Hirohito. That's when the United States Secretary of State, James Francis Burns, had been forced to draft the response that the ultimate form of government shall be established by the freely expressed will of the Japanese people. And that was sent to Japan on the 11th of August, while simultaneously General George Marshall ordered Leslie Groves, not to ship any more fissionable materials to the Pacific, no matter what they had. So in America, most people believed that peace had come. There was all these headlines, Japan offers to surrender. That bannered the New York Times. Another Times story was headlined, GIs in the Pacific go wild with joy. Let them keep their emperor, they say. So they were already spinning it. In Japan, however, the war went on. The Japanese offer of peace and the Allied reply was known only to high government officials. So morning newspapers in Japan on August 11th carried a statement in the name of General Anami, addressed to the army, "The only thing for us to do is fight doggedly." And to the end, though it may mean chewing grass, eating dirt, and sleeping in the field. Now, on August 12th, of course, one of God Emperor's uncles, Prince Asaka, asked whether the war would be continued if the Kokutai, the national polity of total imperial control, could not be preserved. And Hirohito, as I said before, replied, "Moshiran," meaning, of course. And as I said, all of the meaning that was necessary was implied in those two syllables. Now, on August 13th, post-Nagasaki, Lieutenant General John Hull, the Assistant Chief of Staff for Operations and Plans, informed Colonel L.E. Seaman, S-E-E-M-A-N, the guy I mentioned earlier, the aide to Major General Leslie Groves, that the United States Army Chief of Staff, George Marshall, would proceed to use the atom bombs only in direct support of tactical operations. The nuclear war had failed at a strategic level. So Colonel Seaman was expecting 7 uranium little boys from post-ceasefire Germany. This was German ordnance that was brought to them by the Nazi, the actual National Socialist, not a neo-Nazi, the original type of National Socialist, the man who was a hero of World War I and the man who had flown across the Atlantic, Charles Lindbergh, who had been serving in the Pacific, and the day that Franklin Delano Roosevelt died, who said that the Nazi, Charles Lindbergh, would never set foot in Europe again. He, of course, the moment FDR was dead, Truman pulled Charles Lindbergh out of the Pacific and sent him immediately to Europe to get atomic bombs from the Germans. Now, by time of Operation Olympic, November 1st of 1945, they would have only 6 more German little boy bombs that would be rendered available theoretically, July of 1946 for deployment in November of 19—basically, if I remember correctly, I'm trying to get the chronology right. It was around the time that they brought over these 6 uranium shells to clear the beaches. They would be rendered available by July of 1946 because the Germans had to arm them. The Germans had to prime them. The Germans had to essentially assemble them because the Americans had never assembled one. The Americans had scratch-built domestically the fat man, appropriately enough for an American, but the little boys, the thin bombs, the shells around which medium-range German or Japanese bombers would be built, literally framed around the bomb, so that the bombers, either German or Japanese, could deploy them as suicide weapons to take out a city. One man's life for an entire city was well worth it. They had to relocate all 6 of them, get them armed, and delivered. And once a secure beachhead was established, then U.S. soldiers and Marines would, of course, march in atop rivers of glowing radioactive glass. This would be followed eventually by an assembly line of death on an unprecedented scale. They figured by late 1946 they could produce fat man bomb per week, and they could drop one on Japan every week, basically as ordnance support on the ground, line breaker offensives, while American troops advance and exterminate the civilian population, even though they knew they would, they fully expected to lose all of their own personnel to ever-increasing levels of radiation exposure. The Americans didn't care about that. And this is what worried the Japanese military about Emperor Hirohito, because in Japanese tradition, when an enemy storms a castle, what happens is, of course, the loyal samurai retainers will protect the lord's family so that a future lord can be raised to continue that dynastic lineage by offering their own children up in sacrifice, saying those are the children of the Lord, and they will lie and give their own children a sacrifice to save the Lord's children. Now, the military was expected to do that for Emperor Hirohito, and Hirohito had taken it beyond the bounds of that as far as the military was concerned, because Hirohito had set Admiral Yamamoto up for assassination by the United States. Hirohito knew, of course, all of the radio transmissions were being intercepted and read by American code breakers, because Americans had broken the code before Pearl Harbor, which Hirohito knew because of the absence of any carriers and submarines at Pearl Harbor, and the fact that Admiral Halsey was waiting outside with the USS Enterprise without ever attacking on the first 2 waves, even though the Japanese knew he was there because his reconnaissance planes had intercepted the first wave, had actually had combat with them. He hadn't allowed them to land, so they had to fly back to Pearl Harbor and get shot down by their own American anti-aircraft fire. The Japanese witnessed all of this and reported it in their successive 2 waves of attack when, of course, Admiral Yamamoto ordered retreat because he knew the third wave would be intercepted and the Americans had them boxed in. He avoided that ambush, and all the carriers were lost anyway at Midway. Emperor Hirohito knew that only flying aircraft carriers, the super dirigibles, or the submersible aircraft carriers, the super submarines, would be useful in war, and that these floating surface carriers were just turds in a global toilet bowl. They were meant to be flushed. So his sacrifice of the carriers at Midway had the Japanese Navy angry. His sacrifice of Admiral Yamamoto had the military angry, because he knew that Yamamoto was like General Robert E. Lee for the United States Confederacy, a extremely charismatic individual who was very much looked well upon, but at the same time was militarily an idiot and incompetent. If anyone's responsible for losing the war for the Confederate States of America, it's General Robert E. Lee. There should be no statues of that idiot up anywhere. Now, with Yamamoto, of course, the statues of him, as well in Japan, entirely unnecessary. The man was a charismatic incompetent, and Hirohito knew it. But Hirohito, unlike Jefferson Davis of the Confederate States, Hirohito knew to have this son of a bitch killed. So he made certain that transmissions would expose where he was going, sent him on a mission to inspect forces where the Americans could easily take him out. And the Americans, of course, went for it like suckers and saved Hirohito the pain of having to deal with further forces being expended by a military incompetent. Now, Hirohito, of course, was going to win the war. And when he did so, he had to prepare the public for Americans coming in to rebuild Japan via a Gozin Kaigin, an imperial command known as the Voice of the Crane, since the sacred bird of the crane, the family totem of the Yamato dynasty, the totemic animal, could be heard even when it flew unseen above the clouds. So, to the emperor's voice. And that's what provoked the KYŪJŌ-JIKEN. This is what led directly to the war crimes trials, and Emperor Hirohito turning over a bunch of these guys for the Americans to kill. KYŪJŌ-JIKEN, the KYŪJŌ incident, was transliterated into the English as August sans Emperor, or August without the Emperor. On August 14th of 1945, you had the last and largest bombing mission to Japan. Now, please consider what I'm saying. Think of the idiocy of everything you've been told. Hiroshima was destroyed. Nagasaki was destroyed. The Japs surrendered. A war ended. Okay, you've got the last largest bombing mission to Japan well after the Nagasaki bombing on the morning of August 14th. Since the diplomatic situation was considered no clearer to the American public, Truman had to give one last run to show the American public, there's still a war on, until we get some papers that are signed. And so the U.S. bombing missions were resumed. Another blizzard of leaflets swirled over Tokyo and other cities. This time they contained news of the messages exchanged between Japan and the Allies. Maki Koichi Kido, Hirohito's closest advisor, later recorded in his diary that seeing one caused him to be stricken with consternation over the possibility that some leaflets could fall into the hands of the troops and enrage them, making a military coup d'etat inevitable. Now, a coup, in fact, was already underway. If General Anami were to give his support to the plot, much of the Japanese army, a million soldiers in the home islands as its core, would almost certainly rise against the civilian cabinet with the claim that the emperor had been duped by cowardly civilians. If Anami resigned from the cabinet, it would fall. Japan would fight on under a military dictatorship. Now, Kido's frantic urging, the emperor declared another Gozin Kaigin in the air raid shelter, where he issued an imperial command. I desire the cabinet to prepare as soon as possible an imperial rescript announcing the termination of the war. Hirohito knew that publication of the rescript, a proclamation of the gravest import, would not be enough. He decided to be a true voice of the crane. He would step before a microphone and read the rescript to his people, who had never before heard him speak. So on the 14th, 1,014 B-29 bombers hit the Japanese mainland, the largest raid in the Pacific theater of war ever to have happened. Part of the raid involved the 315th Bombardment Wing flying 3,800 miles to destroy the Nippon Oil Company refinery, the longest bombing raid of the war ever to that point. Now, you've got gripping accounts of this, final American bombing mission in World War II, and how it impacted the military coup that could have conceivably kept Japan under a military dictatorship fighting a losing war instead of the technology-driven winning war of their scientist god emperor. Now, how close did cessation of proactive hostilities come to not manifesting on August 15th of 1945? The very interconnections of neglected history could have caused a harrowing shift in the course of the post-war world. Now, on the final night of the proactive war, as Emperor Hirohito was recording this message of peace to the Japanese people, a band of Japanese rebels, commanded by War Minister Anami's own elite staff, burst into the palace. They had plotted a massive coup that aimed to destroy the recordings of the imperial rescript of peace and issue false orders forged with the emperor's seal, commanding the widely dispersed Japanese military to continue the war empire-wide. If this rebellion had succeeded,
the military would have proceeded with large-scale kamikaze attacks on Allied forces, causing huge casualties, and, of course, provoking the Americans to drop their third atomic bomb, likely on Tokyo, even though that wouldn't have destroyed the Imperial bunker, and continued to drop more bombs as Japanese resistance stiffened, even though they wouldn't have more nukes for months and months. Meanwhile, in the midst of the end-of-war celebration on Guam, Air Force radio operator Jim Smith and his fellow crewmen received urgent orders for a bombing mission over Japan's sole remaining oil refinery north of Tokyo. As this stream of American B-29 bombers approached Tokyo, Japanese air defenses, including, of course, interceptors, which scrambled to intercept the American bombers, the Japanese civil defense, the Japanese civilian defense, what we would call civil defense in the United States, it feared the approaching plane signaled the threat of a third atomic bomb over Tokyo. So they ordered a total blackout in Tokyo and the Imperial Palace. And this was parcel to completely disrupting the rebels' plans. Now, Smith and his fellow crew members completed the longest distance mission of the war, almost 4,000 or 5,000 miles. And a few hours later, the emperor announced peace over Japan's airwaves, dictating proactive cessation. In other words, cessation of proactive prosecution of hostilities. So all of this you can see in documentaries made by Americans like The Last Mission. That's the actual title of a documentary. But I'm going to give you now the details. Now, at 11 p.m. on the 15th, Emperor Hirohito was driven the short distance across the palace grounds from his living quarters to the blacked-out building of the household ministry, which ran the affairs of the imperial family. In the audience hall on the second floor, the NHK, that's the National Broadcasting of Japan technicians, bowed to the emperor. They're still around. They still have the same company, just like BBC still runs in Britain. And an officer stated the emperor's broadcast will be on air very soon. Now, at that point, the Japanese version of the Gestapo, the Kempeitai, the Thought Police, where from, of course, George Orwell took the name Thought Police for his book 1984, the Japanese Kempeitai secret police, one of them, a lieutenant, drew his sword and shouted, "There won't be any broadcast, I'm going to kill them all." And he rushed for the studio, but he was subdued, handed over to his very own Kempeitai police force for rebelling against the emperor's orders. And Emperor Hirohito, who was totally unfazed, was far more perplexed by stepping in front of the microphone and said, "How loudly should I speak?" Now, an engineer respectfully, without ever looking at the emperor because it would have been a death sentence to cast his eyes upon him, suggested that he speak in his normal voice. So during his first ever broadcast, the emperor began, "To our good and loyal subjects, after pondering deeply the general trends of the world and the actual conditions obtaining in our empire today, we have decided to effect a settlement of the present situation." Emperor Hirohito famously said, "The war situation has developed not necessarily to Japan's advantage." Now, by way of Japanese sociolinguistics, Japanese discourse oft soundeth very indirect to English speakers, even though Japanese speakers would not necessarily hear it that way. Per the original document, I quote, "But now the war has lasted for nearly 4 years. Despite the best that has been done by everyone, the gallant fighting of the military and naval forces, the diligence and assiduity of our servants of the state, and the devoted service of our 100 million people, the war situation has developed not necessarily to Japan's advantage, while the general trends of the world have all turned against her interest. Let the entire nation continue as one family from generation to generation, ever firm in its faith in the imperishability of its sacred land." Now, talking about archaic language, a Chinese translation, which I got, out of all things, just for shit and grins and giggles, out of Chinese Wikipedia, used the appropriate classical Chinese to translate his speech. If this were in the late 19th century, it would have been written in Kanbun first, a very specialized form of iconography. Now, the Japanese there, the line reading in the Nihongo, Japanese language, "Kuso kyoko kanonazu sushi moko sesu seke no tase mata waga nire arasu," line is rendered in the Putonghua, or the Mandarin Chinese, classical, mind you, of the actual Mandarins, the literary elite. "Yejang ju bing we hajuan shijia de shiye buri wu yuwo." The war situation has developed not necessarily to Japan's advantage, while the general trends of the world have all turned against her interest.
The context of the statement is both his praising the Japanese people's devotion during trying times and his standing order for them to maintain such devotion in continuity, not some explanation for any decision to surrender. Russo-American propagandists malevolently misinterpret an entirely non-existent rationalization for a fictitious surrender in the following sentence I will quote, wherein Emperor Hirohito discusses the atomic bomb. And to quote it, the enemy has begun to employ a new and most cruel bomb, the power of which to do damage is indeed incalculable, taking the toll of many innocent lives. Should we continue to fight, not only would it result in an ultimate collapse and obliteration of the Japanese nation, but it would also lead to the total extinction of human civilization. Now, think of what I have just stated. Here there be no dissimulation in phraseology. Not only would it result in an ultimate collapse and obliteration of the Japanese nation, but also it would lead to the total extinction of human civilization. Americanists insist this phrase could be couched in Japanese religious symbolism, in the dogma of Japanese extremist Buddhist and Shinto sects, asserting such belief that the Japanese people are the entirety of human civilization. So Japanophobic propagandists easily find many citations in Japanese religious writings where Japan is described as the world. And if Japan falls, the world falls. Ergo, for the emperor, seeing Japan destroyed was equal to having the whole world destroyed. With this phrase, the emperor establishes that by surrendering in order to protect the remaining Japanese people, he is acting as a god to protect all of mankind. This is preposterous. It is to present the Japanese people as racist, ethno-religious bigots. It is bullshit. It is mutually assured destruction. It is the first statement of mutually assured destruction where Emperor Hirohito is Nikita Khrushchev style saying, we will bury you. Moreover, the speech was delivered in the semi-archaic courtly variety of Japanese, which only nobility, as my late and sainted Cyrus, erosprakis on ceremony, which has two important implications, the first being that translation would be very difficult. Since the speech was in courtly Japanese, obscure even in 1945, exactly how to interpret this line is not clear to foreigners. Some modern commentators accept the understatement reasoning, as in typical British or Japanese understatement. Some people claim that cited passage means things have definitely not gone well for us, per usage of the few words, kinorazushimo, meaning air frost, as in permafrost, the key word corresponding to not necessarily in the Americanist translation of the poetry, has been acknowledged as grossly misleading over these many years, as Japanese have always known it to mean, despite everyone's efforts, that being implied, Japanese being a pro-drop language, things will not necessarily improve for us. Factoring furthermore, most Japanese in 1945 would have found the emperor's announcement very difficult to understand in the first place. Even those who were comfortable with classical Japanese, much more used to reading the language like that than hearing it spoken. Now, there are examples via Shakespearean stage English. Whenever my womb matron and I and my late and sainted sire, my father, when my father, mother, and myself basically reviewed Japanese historical dramas together as a family, my mother would point out that translation was impacted by the fact that the people on the screen were speaking a Japanized form of what Americans would interpret as Shakespearean English. They weren't speaking Japanese as it was spoken today. So the low quality of the recording didn't help either. Historically, there was a follow-up broadcast which explained the announcement in plain everyday Japanese, but that is impossible to track down, as the American military requested every copy for destruction so that it could never be coherently translated into plain American English. That means that it's highly problematic to ascertain by this chronometric point in time how ordinary Japanese would even have understood the speech. As far as how the speech is remembered today, and again, just for shits and grins and giggles, I turned towards the American Wikipedia, the bathroom wall of information intercourse, and there it stated, the most well-remembered phrase in Japan is this one, as quoted, it is according to the dictates of time and fate that we have resolved to pave the way for a grand peace for all the generations to come by enduring the unendurable and suffering what the unsufferable. And so by mine own sainted matron's experience, I know for a fact that at the time there was no doubt whatsoever that Japan not at all surrendered, as the overwhelming majority of Japanese peoples concluded that they had to prepare to fight a land invasion.
But it was rapidly ascertained that Emperor Hirohito merely meant unruly guests must be tolerated in reconstruction, that we're going to have a bunch of pig slobs who are going to come over, and we need them to do the shit work. To that very end, American GIs were forced to work on site both the Japanese atomic blast sites immediately following ceasefire. First, demands of the Japanese government to prevent overexposure of any additional Japanese personnel or civilians. And these United States GIs were compelled to do so without safety gear by their own United States government, specifically to measure rates at which their hair fell out and how long it took for their bodies to become covered in sores. And the American mass radiation exposure subjects were considered advantageous because of their native speaker fluency in English, their lack of cultural barriers. This enabled United States federal scientists to immediately comprehend their descriptions of symptoms as they deteriorated throughout the rest of their short lives. So the first large groups of American soldiers arrived in Nagasaki on September 23rd of 1945, and in Hiroshima 2 weeks later. They were part of a force, 240,000, that occupied the islands of Honshu and Kyushu. Marines from the 2nd Division took Nagasaki, while the United States Army's 24th and 31st Divisions seized Hiroshima. No one was urged to take precautions. They were ordered instead to bivouac on Ground Zero and sleep on the earth and engage in cleanup operations without any protective gear. And, of course, when I dealt with personnel documents, one example sticks out in my mind. An American Marine named Sam Skion, who returned to the United States a year later, his body covered in sores and his hair falling out, suffered a string of ailments, was never awarded service-related disability status. None of those GIs were. He was but among tens of thousands of such cases. And during the year after the bombing, approximately 40,000 U.S. occupation troops were in Hiroshima. Nagasaki was occupied by 27,000 troops. Upper limit dose estimates for those troops range from, 0.19 to 0.3 MSV for Hiroshima, about 0.8 to 6.3 MSV for Nagasaki, depending on location. You can look these up yourself. Radiation dose reconstruction, U.S. occupation forces in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Japan, 1945 to 1946. It's a federal form or document, DNA 5512F, if I remember the resource number, and the DTRA fact sheets, Hiroshima and Nagasaki occupation forces. Now, all of that was what Hirohito demanded, and what he got as the winner. Now, all considered, when Hirohito finished speaking, he asked the technician near him, "Is that all right?" And the chief engineer stammered, "There were no technical errors, but a few words were not entirely clear." So the emperor read the rescript again and expressed he would do so a third time if need be. Each reading was only 4.5 minutes long, but the speech spanned 2 records, the black wax discs we used to make, or print out. And the technicians picked the first set of records for the broadcast. They kept all 4, putting them in metal cases, then into khaki bags. And the technicians, like everyone else in the palace, had heard the rumors of a coup. They decided to stay there that night rather than attempt a return to the NHK broadcasting studio out of fear that army mutineers would attempt to steal and destroy the recordings. A chamberlain placed the records in a safe in a small office used by a member of the emperor's retinue, a room normally off limits to men. Then he hid the safe with a pile of papers. And on August 15th, that very time, the United States was declaring comprehensive ceasefire in effect. Plus, the newly created American Joint Army-Navy Committee on Japanese Air Forces estimated Japanese air strength on the home islands alone at 5,911 aircraft, about 6,000 aircraft, per Magic Far East submarines, Magic being the code name for the deciphering or the cryptography code-breaking system. That was published on 19th July 1945 and 9th August follow-up on 1945. And, of course, on that same day, climatic Japano-Soviet battles had begun for the Chishima Archipelago, known as the Kuril Islands, to the Russians and Americans. And in the early hours of August 15th, at the Imperial Guard's headquarters, the convergent tension expressed itself in the murder of both Lieutenant General Takeshi Mori, commander of the Imperial Guard's division, and his brother-in-law, Lieutenant Colonel Michinori Shirashi, if I remember correctly. Major Kenji Hatanaga was a fiery-eyed zealot and Army Air Force captain, and also his companion, Captain Shigetaro Uehara. They burst into the offices of General Mori, fatally shot him, prior butchering his body with a katana, a samurai sword. Officer Uehara beheaded another officer. 2 young officers looked into the murdered general's office as a third wiped Mori's blood from his sword. The hacked, bleeding bodies lay on the floor beneath them with blood still spurting from their wounds.
The lieutenant colonel had his head sliced off. The office walls were liberally splashed with red. The floor was both dark and slippery. Hatanaka affixed Mori's private seal to a false order directing the Imperial Guards to occupy the palace and its grounds. Sever communications with the palace except through division headquarters. Occupy NHK, the National Broadcasting Studios, and prohibit all broadcasts. Meanwhile, Major Hedemasa Koga, a staff officer with the Imperial Guards, was trying to recruit other officers into the plot. At the palace, soldiers supporting the coup with bayonets affixed to the rifles rounded up the radio technicians and imprisoned them in a barracks wearing white bands, the Japanese version of black, or Asian version of black. Throughout Asia, it's the color of death is white. So they were wearing like bands of mourning across their chest to distinguish themselves from guards loyal to the emperor. They stormed the palace and began cutting telephone wires. Now, Koga, hoping to find and destroy what he thought was the single record of the emperor's message, ordered a radio technician to find it. The technician, unfamiliar with the palace, led several soldiers into the labyrinthine internal palace structure. Soldiers roamed the palace buildings, kicking in doors, flinging contents of chests onto polished floors. The emperor himself remained in his quarters and watched it all through a slit in the steel shutters protecting his windows. Lieutenant Colonel Takeshita, meanwhile, tried to bring Anami into the plot. Anami declined, having already planned his own suicide to escape participation in the plot. With Takeshita in the room, Anami knelt on a mat, drove a wakizashi, a samurai dagger, into his stomach, the short sword, drew it across his waist, bleeding profusely. He then removed the knife, thrust it into his own neck. Takeshita pushed the knife deeper until Anami finally died as a mercy killing. Meanwhile, Maki Kido, Hirohito's relative and privy seal holder, was hidden from the plotters. And rebellious soldiers were swarming into the NHK building, locking employees in the studio, demanding assistance so they could go on the air and urge the nation to fight on in an unstrategic fashion without Hirohito's competent direction. Shortly before 5 a.m. on August 15th, Hatanaka walked into Studio 2, put a pistol to the head of Morio Tateno, an announcer, and said he was taking over the 5 o'clock news show. Now, Tateno refused to let him near the microphone. Hatanaka, who had just killed an army general, cocked his pistol, but he was so impressed by Tateno's courage, he lowered the gun. And an engineer, meanwhile, had disconnected the building from the broadcasting tower. If Hatanaka had spoken into the microphone, his words would have gone nowhere. At the Imperial Palace, the emperor was wide awake, listening as his court chamberlains debated how best to safeguard his majesty's life if it came to that. But it was decided to bar all the doors and fasten all the gobunko's shutters. That's the gobunko being the super bunker, the lead-lined atomic shelter. But the shutters had become so rusted over many years of non-use that the chamberlains were unable to shut them. So finally, they ordered some tough young imperial guards to bar all the windows. One chamberlain mused how ironic it was that this was being done against Japanese and elite imperial guards at that, not against enemy soldiers. And later, Premier Suzuki's residence was machine-gunned. Kido's villa was attacked. The chamberlain Yoshihiro Tokugawa faced down his dispatch killers. According to one account, Tokugawa was assaulted. A fist struck him full in the face. He fell to the floor, his eyeglasses crushed beneath him. In 1960, a full 15 years after the events of August 1945, an army sergeant sought out Chamberlain Tokugawa to offer an apology for having hit him, bringing a peace offering, or rather as his peace offering, an important family possession, a tea kettle made from a bronze mirror. But for now, the Imperial Library itself was surrounded by rebellious troops. I still can't believe it was what Fujita said, who opened one of the iron shutters to peep out and seeing knots of Imperial guards occupying key posts between the Fukiaji Gate and the Gubonku. The machine guns were being placed with their muzzles pointing directly at the house of the emperor. So it took most of a night for troops loyal to the emperor himself to round up the rebels. At dawn, they finally removed the mutineers from palace grounds. Prime Minister Hideki Tojo's own son-in-law, Major Hidemasa Koga, sliced open his own stomach in the sign of a crucifix, showing that he was actually a Christian. It was recalled later in his seppuku, or what Americans bastardize as harakiri, the ritual suicide. And now, judging for it safe to leave, the NHK engineers brought the emperor's records to the radio station in separate cars, using different routes. They hid one set in an underground studio and prepared to play the other. At 7:21 a.m., Tateno went on the air and without recounting the adventures of the night before, announced, "His Majesty the Emperor has issued a rescript. It will be broadcast at noon today. Let us all respectfully listen to the voice of the Emperor. Power will be specially transmitted to those districts where it is not usually available during daylight hours. Receivers should be prepared and ready at all railroad stations, postal departments, and offices, both government and private. And at noon throughout Japan, as the emperor's voice was heard, people sobbed. It was sudden mass hysteria on a national scale. That according to Kazuo Kawe, the editor of the Nippon Times, the emperor spoke in the classical language that was not at all understandable to Japanese people. And of course, what happened was that the only thing the people understood was that Emperor Hirohito never used the words defeat or surrender. The words surrender, capitulate, failure, and defeat are entirely absent from the Japanese imperial rescript, as officially translated by the United States itself, and reflecting, literally, the Japanese original, and published in both English and Japanese, on page number one of the Nippon Times, on the 15th of August, in 1945. That's why the anniversary of 1945's August 15th ceasefire, propagandized as VJ Day, or Victory in Japan Day in the United States, and an unconditional surrender to a war-weary American public, is officially recognized in Japan as Senbochusho o Suitoshie wa o Kinensuru. This translates as Day of Mourning of War Dead and Praying for Peace, as peace would not be established until 1952. Now, after the broadcast, Major Kenji Hatanaka ended his mutiny standing outside the palace gates trying to hand out leaflets that called on civilians to join with us to fight for the preservation of our country and the elimination of the traitors around the emperor. No one would dare to take any of the leaflets, so Hatanaka shot himself in the head. Now, the imperial rescript to the soldiers and sailors and officers issued on August 17th, 1945, makes no reference whatsoever to the atomic bombs, as the American terrorist attacks on civilians had no effect on military assets in the field. And on August 18th, the Battle of Shimushu took place, where the Imperial Japanese Navy Type 2 Kami amphibious tanks were deployed and wiped out the Russians, blew them out of the water at waterline, so they couldn't land on the northernmost main island of Hokkaido. And on August 28th, at the request of General Douglas MacArthur, you had that satanic flag transported from Annapolis, Maryland, to be on hand for the ceasefire ceremony of the Japanese ending World War II's proactive phase of hostilities. And this was the flag that had an inversion of the number 13, 31 stars all upside down in the shape of the satanic star of Baphomet, the sigil devoted to satanic slavery under which the United States truly served. And that was flown in a 9,500-mile trip that took 120 hours, 5 days, covered 12 time zones. The backside of that flag is white to offer surrender. That was the whole symbolism, was it's an American surrender flag under their satanic leadership, their true service being to the Dark Lord and the infernal depths of hell. And the courier, with orders that required him to keep the wooden box containing the satanic flag in his sight at all times, slept with it, ate with it, took it with him to the bathroom. The flag case was mounted on the bulkhead of the battleship Missouri overlooking the circus ceremony. After its 120-hour, 5-day trip, the courier slept for 2 days, missing the 18-minute ceremony. And for his part, Japan's Emperor Hirohito didn't even deign to dignify the unrecognized service by appearing in person. He instead sent a delegation consisting of Foreign Minister Mamoru Shigemitsu for the government, the Chief of Army's Imperial General Staff, Yoshijiro Umezo, as well as Admiral Sanatoshi Tomioka to represent the Navy that had conducted the first phase of operations at Pearl Harbor back in 1941. And it's both photographically and cinematically documented that the Japanese military representatives aboard the USS Missouri bear no katana or samurai swords to surrender. Now, bear in mind the standing orders on what the American public should be told about World War II as issued by the U.S. Navy's second most senior officer after Fleet Admiral William D. Lee, as well as the second admiral to be promoted to 5-star rank, Commander-in-Chief, United States Fleet, CINCUS, and Chief of Naval Operations, COMINC, CNO, the Fleet Admiral Ernest Joseph King stated, "Don't tell them anything they don't need to know. When it's over, tell them who won." Well, the Soviets didn't win. On September 3rd, the Soviet Habome Islands consolidations commenced, and on September 5th, they finally consolidated the last of that chain of islands, which the Japanese still demand to this day, off the coast of Hokkaido, that keeps Russia and Japan still legally at war. Now, all of this shows the failure of American strategic bombing. The bombing was purely genocidal. Everyone said the atomic bombs were meaningless without any military impact. And ahead for MacArthur lay his term as Allied Shogun of post-war Japan under imperial direction. And, of course, he would have his tumultuous Korean War on the peninsula and his firing by President Truman. Now, the reason all of this is so important is because I can give you every reference that the bombs were thoroughly discredited by the American military themselves. Consequently, the United States' nuclear terrorism has been conventionally revisioned as the theatrical opening of the so-called Cold War, aimed at sending a message to the Soviets. Now, that was part already of America surrendering its mind to the Soviets by saying, oh, this was a message to the Soviets. Why would they need a message when Stalin already knew about the bombs, wasn't worried about them, wouldn't be nuclear capable himself until 1949? And you got that myth from Rob Edwards and people like him who wrote articles like Hiroshima bomb may have carried a hidden agenda. That was published in the New Scientist magazine back in 2005. Now, please note, this is an opinion article on findings suggesting Japan was already looking for peace and that surrendered due to the Soviet invasion, and that Truman's true aim was to demonstrate U.S. powers to the Soviets. Now, all that has radically changed as of the year 2013, when on May 29th of that year, Ward Wilson wrote an article in Foreign Policy that expresses the new shift of your intelligentsia and academia. The title of his article, Ward Wilson, what he wrote is, "The bomb didn't beat Japan, Stalin did." See, all of this was going on as I became a public informant. Now, when I became a public informant and proved definitively these bombs were meaningless as anything other than acts of terror, then the entire intelligentsia and academia that is paid for by your U.S. military junta had to change their tune and say, well, it was a message to the Soviets. By the time I proved already that didn't mean shit because Stalin already knew about it and that he wouldn't be nuclear until 1949, then everything had to change again for the damage control and spin directly on basis of what Douglas Dietrich has exposed. And now your foreign policy magazines, your official policy of your State Department says, well, the bomb didn't beat Japan at all. Stalin did. Now, why is this so alarming? Because one of your greatest philosophers, one of the true thinking men of your society, E.L. Doctorow. Look up E.L. Doctorow. You can find his resume. I don't need to give you his biography. His quote, the most important one he stated in his life was, "The bomb first was our weapon. Then it became our diplomacy. Next it became our economy. Now it's become our culture. We've become the people of the bomb." That's why in the Planet of the Apes, you see all those mutated white trash pieces of shit literally worshipping the Alpha and the Omega of the bomb. That was meant to personify, to embody what E.L. Doctorow was saying. This is what Americans were now, worshippers of the bomb, the cult of the atom, the church being the Atomic Energy Commission, which ran your radiological experiments and genetic experiments under budget of the U.S. military. And with this kind of worshipful ignorance that you had that the bomb won the war, now we turn our entire economy to the bomb. Now we turn all our science to the bomb. Now it's the Russians. So instead of becoming the people of the bomb who worship the bomb, as you did in the Planet of the Apes, where its very radiation was mutating the white trash pieces of shit into horribly deformed and scarred individuals incestuously breeding underground in the Appalachian Mountains, what you have now is you saying, it's not the bomb. It's the Russians. And that's why you drink Russian piss and eat Russian shit as the turds drop out of Putin's asshole. That's why you suck cock along with Donald Trump of every Russian that comes along. So when a Russian walks in the room, you guys bend over and split your ass cheeks and say, give it to me here. Because you're all so fucking stupid. You think, well, if the bomb didn't beat the Japs, it had to be the white Russians. They're white like us. Now we have a new religion. Get over it. The man who ended the war was Harry Truman. When he surrendered to the Japanese, and we'll go into some detail of that on Monday, because that's the eve day of the bombing, the actual day of the massive bombing I described, and the day of the speech. Cover everything.